नंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यशोदा नंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यमुना तीरावन चारी यमुना तीरावन चारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी जय गोपी जन वल्लभ गिरिवर धारी जय गोपी जन वल्लभ गिरिवर धारी यशोदानंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यशोदानंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यमुना तीरावन चारी यमुना तीरावन चारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी गोपी जन वल्लभ गिरिवर धारी जय गोपी जन वल्लभ गिरिवर धारी यशोदानंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यशोदानंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यमुना तीरावन चारी यमुना तीरावन चारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Nitai Gaur Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Nitai Gaur Hari Bol. Jaya Jaya Prabhupad, 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 Jaya Jaya Prabhupad.
Jayam Vishnu Pad Paramahamsa Parivrajaka Acharya Stotarita Shri Srimad Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Ananta Koti Vaishnavanda Ki Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Nitay Gaur Premanande Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Narayanam Namaskritya Naram Chaiva Narottamam Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam Tato Jayamudirayet Nashta Prayeshva Bhadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavati Uttama Shloke Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtiki
Hare Krishna. So we are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 27, Text number 49 and 50. Text 49. Evam kriya yoga pathai Puman vaidika tantrikaihi Archan bhayata siddhim Matto vindatya bhipsitam
evam kriya yoga pathai puman vaidika tantrikaihi archan ubhayatas siddhim matto vindatya bhipsitam evam kriya yoga pathai puman vaidika tantrikaihi archan ubhayatas siddhim matto vindatya bhipsitam archan ubhayatas siddhim matto vindatya bhipsitam evam kriya yoga pathai puman vaidika tantrikai archan ubhayatas siddhim matto vindatya bhipsitam evam kriya yoga pathai puman vaidika tantrikaihi archan ubhayatas siddhim matto vindatya bhipsitam evam in this way kriya yoga of regulated deity worship pathaihi by the processes puman a person vaidika tantrikaihi presented in the Vedas and Tantras archan worshipping ubhayata in both this life and the next siddhim perfection mattah from me vindati he achieves abhipsitam desired translation by worshipping me through the various methods prescribed in the Vedas and Tantras one will gain from me his desired perfection in both this life and the next text 15 मदर्चां संप्रतिष्ठाप्य मंदिरं कारये दृढं पुष्पोद्यानानि रम्याणि पूजायात्रोत्सवाश्रितान् द डिवोटी शुड मोर फुली एस्टैब्लिश माय डीटी बाय सॉलिडली कंस्ट्रक्टिंग ए टेंपल अलोंग विथ ब्यूटिफुल गार्डन्स दीज गार्डन्स शुड बी सेट असाइड टू प्रोवाइड फ्लावर्स फॉर द रेगुलर डेली वर्शिप स्पेशल डीटी प्रोसेशंस and holiday observances purport by disciples of Srila Prabhupada wealthy pious persons should be engaged in constructing temples and gardens for the pleasure of the deity the word dridham indicates that the most solid means of construction should be employed om ajnana timirandasya gyananjana shalakaya चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपा कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं वन्देहं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरून् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातां सहगणा रघुनाथान्वितं तां सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनासहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधा कृष्णपादान् सहगणा ललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधो दीनबंधो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिका कांता राधा कांता नमोस्तुते Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhyevacha Patitanam Pavane Bhyo Vaishnave Bhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna. I'd like to seek the blessings of all the assembled devotees here. So I didn't know what exactly to speak because the section of deity worship has been going on for a long time and most of the devotees have covered almost everything that I know about deity worship. But still I'll try to say something, whatever little I understand. In one article by Satyaraj Prabhu, he talks about worshipping the form of God, which is supported even in other religions. Especially he talks about Bible and the Western Jewish tradition. And he quotes several references where even these scriptures support, not exactly worship, but they accept the form of God. So there are several Hollywood movies where they show people thrashing and smashing the deities, not deities, idols of ancient traditions and how they reject the form of God. And then he goes on to prove what exactly the scriptures meant when it said that you should not worship a form. So most of the references where they condemn worship of a form is referring to forms other than those of God. Like he quotes several references. He says, God says in the Bible, he says, thou shall have no other gods before me. Who is saying? God is saying this to one of his devotees. And It seems in those times, in that land of Israel and other, somewhere near Jerusalem, they used to worship a form of a calf, golden calf. So those are the forms, and many other forms they used to worship. But this golden calf, it seems, was a prominent worship in those times, in that area. So there, so that kind of worship was not approved by the Bible. Then there is a statement, thou shall not make unto thee any carved image or any likeness of anything that is in the sky above or on earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. So in short, it's saying any material form that you find in the material world, in the material creation, you shouldn't make a form of those and start worshipping them. Thou shalt not bow down to them, nor serve them. And then he says, the Bible asserts that God has a form, but only the most qualified will ever get to see it. You have neither heard his voice at any time, nor seen his shape. This is another statement from the Bible. And it says the semblance of a human form. So it seems two-handed form it's referring to. And it says, God appeared in a human-like form, although the form is not elaborately described. In one verse, the Lord tells Abraham about this. And he looked upon him. So Abraham, it seems, is able to behold the form of God. And then he says, there is an encounter with one person called Jacob.
something similar to Krishna fighting with our coward boys. So Jacob is having a wrestling match with God. And in that fight, he dislocates his shoulder bone. And he says, that the Jacob later says, this man was actually God. I have seen God face to face and my life is preserved. So all these references are there in the biblical traditions. And so in those times, people used to feel that as soon as you get the darshan of God, you will instantly die. But some people never died even after seeing God. So that misconception was gone. So these are the traditions, and even in Islamic scriptures, you may find similar references, which I don't have them here. But in our tradition, in the Vedic tradition, we find elaborate descriptions of that human form, human God. Like our famous verse, Venum Konantam Aravinda Dalayataksham Barhavatam Samasitam Buddha Sundarangam Kandarpa Koti Kamaniya Vishesha Shobham Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. So Prabhupada explains that whatever beauty you see in this world, Yadyad Vibhuti Matsattvam Srimadurjitam Eva, whatever beautiful creation is visible in this world is a reflection of the original beauty of Krishna, which means Krishna has a beautiful form. So anthropomorphism means you imagine a form of God based on our form. So if that is the case, then you can't explain how there is beautiful creation in this world. But when we understand the original form, God has an original form, and we are fashioned, our form is fashioned out of the form of God. And all other beautiful creations that we see is also a reflection of Krishna's beauty. Then that is complete explanation. If the form of God is fashioned out of our imagination, then there is no answer for the beautiful creation in the world. How did they come? So in this way, so many other references in the Bhagavatam, you find a description about Krishna's beautiful form, his bluish complexion, yellow dhoti and peacock feather, all those details, flute. So we have a lot of things to meditate upon. Even Vishnu's form, you find several descriptions in the third canto. So in the nectar of devotion, I thought I'll go back to our Bhakti Shastri syllabus and revise some points we did long time back, which we may have forgotten. So in the nectar of devotion, there are several, in the 64 items of devotional service, we find several points that talk exclusively about deity worship. So this is chapter 7. One should decorate the body with tilak, which is the sign of the Vaishnavas. So when we mark our body with tilak, we are remembering Krishna's various names in those particular places. Mahaprabhu used to say that a Vaishnava is he who, when seen, reminds one of Krishna. Therefore, it is essential that a Vaishnava marks his body with tilak, so that we can remind others of Krishna. Then, in marking such tilak, sometimes one may write Hare Krishna on the body. Or Prem Keshav Prabhu does that oftentimes on his body. One should accept flowers and garlands that have been offered to the deity and the spiritual master and put them on one's body. So we should, now due to this epidemic, we may not do that for the time being. But otherwise, it's a devotional item, one of the 64 items, to smell the flowers and decorate our body with those flowers. One should learn to dance before the deity, which we all do that. One should learn to bow down immediately upon seeing the deity or the spiritual master. This also we do, may not be so strictly, The first time when we see the deity, we may do. But when we keep, if we keep entering the room every now and then, we may not do that. But it's recommended that we do. As soon as one visits the temple of Lord Krishna, one must stand up. When the deity is being borne for a stroll in the street, a devotee should immediately follow the procession. When the deity is coming out, the servitors in the temple put forward the daily accounts before them. So much was the collection, so much was the expenditure. The whole idea is that the deity is considered as the proprietor of the whole establishment. And all the priests and other people taking care of the temple are considered to be the servants of the deity. This we do once in a year during Brahmotsavam. When we met Narsingh Kavach Prabhu in Mayapur last month, and we presented how we would like to celebrate our Chandan Yatra nicely, because there are so many restrictions on decorating in certain way. So we asked, can we do this, can we do that? So he said, in the nectar of devotion, so many details are presented. Why don't you follow those, if at all you are so interested about elaborate worship? These things you do. Take the deity on procession and present the accounts and present your reports, preaching reports, other reports. This was the option he gave. A devotee must visit a Vishnu temple at least once or twice every day, morning and evening. Then, one must circumambulate the temple building at least 3 times. So here, some devotees I see doing on Lakshmi Narayan temple circumambulation. But this is not a very common thing. Our temple, Padi Parikrama. Acha. Then this can include also Govardhan Parikrama, Vrindavan Parikrama, and other Parikrama of holy places. One must worship the deity in the temple according to the regulative principles. This which we are already doing. Many devotees staying outside at home, Grihastas also do this. Installing deity and following the regular daily worship. Aarti and bhoga offerings and putting the deities to rest, waking them up. One must render personal service to the deities. So, besides following the worship within the system, we should also offer personal service. Like we have devotees who get flowers every day morning, personally going and collecting flowers, and personally doing some menial service in the backup room or the jewelry room. So, this is not a part of the system. But taking out extra time and doing all these little things, painting. So one must find out if we can do such services. One must sing. This we do quite often. One must perform sankirtan. One must chant. One must offer prayers. Prayers is something which we may try to do more often. Sometimes our prayers can be mechanical or ritualistic. So having customized prayer, besides reciting the standard prayers that we do every day, besides repeating the prayers of great acharyas and other scriptures, having a customized personal individual prayer is also recommended. And then one must recite notable prayers. One must taste Mahaprasad, food from the very plate offered to the deities. This we do without saying. One must drink Charanamrit, water from the bathing of the deities which is offered to the guests. One must smell the incense and flowers offered to the deity. One must touch the lotus feet of the deity. One must see the deity with great devotion. That's also a challenge many times. One must offer aarti at different times. So because we are living in the temple, it's easier. But for those who are staying at home, this could be difficult. One must hear about the Lord and His pastimes from Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita and similar books. This also we do. but it can be ritualistic when we do it every day. One must pray to the deity for his mercy. One should remember the deity, especially when we are out of the temple, out of direct physical closeness. One should meditate upon the deity. One should render some voluntary service. One should think of the Lord as one's friend. So thinking of the Lord as one's friend doesn't mean we start imagining we are in Sakhyaras and that kind of dealings. But like in one article, Mahatma Prabhu writes, if you have a problem and you are struggling to solve the problem, figure out a solution, make the deity your partner, the problem's partner. So that way your anxiety reduces. So you do your job of trying to solve, and the rest is deity's problem or the Lord's problem. So then he also will work on solving the problem. So that way we are like sharing or treating the Lord as a friend. Like we have some devotees who have businesses named after the deity. The profits are shared, the expenditure is shared. Then one should offer everything to the Lord. One should offer a favorite article, such as food or a garment, to the deity. One should take all kinds of risks and perform all endeavors for Krishna's benefit. This can be circumstantial. In every condition, we have histories where devotees have sacrificed their lives for protecting the deity, so taking all kinds of risk. One should, in every condition, one should be a surrendered soul. One should pour water on the tulsi tree. One should regularly hear Srimad Bhagavatam and similar literature. One should live in a sacred place like Mathura, Vrindavan or Dwarka. One should offer service to Vaishnavas. One should arrange one's devotional service according to one's means. This we will elaborate a little later. In the month of Kartik, one should make arrangements for special services. During Janmashtami, one should observe a special service. One should do whatever is done with great care and devotion for the deity. One should relish the pleasure of Bhagavatam reading among devotees and not among outsiders. One should associate with devotees who are considered more advanced. One should chant the holy name of the Lord. One should live in the jurisdiction of Mathura. So these are the 44 items, besides the first 20 most important do's and don'ts that Rupa Goswami prescribes. Then in the next chapter also we find there are several offenses listed that one may commit voluntarily, involuntarily, unknowingly. So he quotes 32 offenses that one may commit. One should not enter the temple of the deity in a car or palanquin or with shoes on the feet. This is a general tradition in India, everyone knows this. One should not fail to observe the various festivals for the pleasure of the Supreme Lord, such as Janmashtami and Rathayatra. One should not avoid bowing down before the deity. One should not enter the temple to worship the Lord without having washed one's hands and feet after eating. One should not enter the temple in a contaminated state. So what is a contaminated state? If someone dies in the family, the whole family becomes contaminated for some time. For a Brahmana, the contamination period is 12 days. For a Kshatriya and Vaishya, it is 15 days. And for Shudras, it is 30 days. One should not bow down on one hand. We have a bead bag, we may do that. One should not circumambulate in front of Sri Krishna. I'm not very sure what it means. I think, yeah, rotate self. The process of circumambulating the temple is that one should begin circumambulating from the deity's right hand side of the temple and come round. Such circumambulation should be performed outside the temple structure at least 3 times a day. This is the recommendation. One should not spread his legs before the deity. One should not sit before the deity holding the ankles, elbows or knees with one's hands. One should not lie down before the deity of Krishna. One should not accept prasad before the deity. One should never speak a lie before the deity. One should not talk very loudly before the deity. One should not talk with others before the deity. One should not cry or howl before the deity. One should not quarrel or fight before the deity. One should not chastise anyone before the deity. One should not be charitable to beggars before the deity. This is an interesting point. By showing charity, we are trying to show that I am the one who is maintaining the beggar. And it's like taking ownership. One should not speak very harshly to others before the deity. One should not wear a fur blanket before the deity. One should not eulogize or praise anyone else before the deity. One should not speak any ill names before the deity. Can't imagine this can also happen. One should not pass air before the deity. One should not fail to worship the deity according to one's means. So Rupa Goswami quotes, Patram Pushpam Phalam Toyam. Simplest items can also please Krishna. But that does not mean that one should not, one who has sufficient means to worship the Lord very nicely, should also adopt this method and try to satisfy the Lord with simple offerings. If he has sufficient means, he should offer nice decorations, nice flowers, nice foodstuffs, and observe all ceremonies. One should not eat anything which is not offered first to Krishna. This can be a challenge to us because we assume that anything that comes to the temple is offered. And we gulp it oftentimes, which may not be true all the times. One should not fail to offer fresh fruit and grains to Krishna according to the season. This is also a challenge nowadays because all fruits are available throughout the year. Which is a seasonal fruit, which is a special fruit, that's not very clear. After food has been cooked, no one should be offered any foodstuffs unless it is first offered to the deity. One should not sit with his back towards the deity. One should not offer obeisances silently to the spiritual master. Or in other words, one should recite aloud the prayers to the spiritual master while offering obeisances. Aloud. One should not fail to offer some praise in the presence of the spiritual master. One should not praise himself before the spiritual master. One should not deride the demigods before the deity. So these are 32 offenses. Besides, Prabhupada lists another set of offenses from the Varaha Purana. One should not touch the deity in a dark room. One should not fail to strictly follow the rules and regulations in worshipping the deity. One should not enter the temple of the deity without first making some sound. 3 claps. One should not offer any foodstuff to the deity which has been seen by dogs or other lower animals. One should not break silence while worshipping. One should not pass urine or evacuate while engaged in worshipping. One should not offer incense without offering some flower. Useless flowers without any fragrance should not be offered. That is also a challenge nowadays. So in another place, Prabhupada talks about growing our own flowers than purchasing flowers. So if we can have, like in the purport we saw, we should have gardens exclusively growing flowers for the worship of the deity. So because that is not always feasible, we have to purchase. Similarly, that principle can also apply for food. Ideally, we should grow our own food, cook, and then offer. If that is not possible, we purchase the grains and then offer. If that is also not possible, we purchase the food, cooked food, and then that offer that. One should not fail to wash his teeth very carefully every day. This is an offense if you don't do it. One should not enter the temple directly after sexual intercourse. One should not touch a woman during her menstrual period. One should not enter the temple after touching a dead body. One should not enter the temple wearing garments of red or blue color, or garments which are unwashed. I don't know the significance behind this, red and blue. Maybe passion and ignorance. Red represents passion and blue represents ignorance. One should not enter the temple after seeing a dead body. One should not pass air within the temple. One should not be angry within the temple. One should not enter the temple after visiting a crematorium. One should not belch before the deity. So until one has fully digested his food, he should not enter the temple, which means he should eat early. One should not smoke marijuana or ganja. One should not take opium or similar intoxicants. One should not enter the deity room or touch the body of the deity after having smeared oil over his body. That's a challenge for me. Sometimes when I search for pujaris, they've already applied oil. And then I have to look for another pujari. One should not show disrespect to a scripture teaching about the supremacy of the Lord. One should not introduce any opposing scripture. One should not chew beetle before the deity. One should not offer a flower which was kept in an unclean pot. One should not worship the Lord while sitting on the bare floor. One must have a sitting place or carpet. One should not touch the deity before one has completed taking bath. We see that, like Prem Krishna was narrating the story of Madhavendra Puri, that Brahmana, the Khirchor Gopinath Pujari, the deity came in his dream and said that you take this kheer and hand it over to Madhavendra Puri. So immediately took bath. And just because the deity has ordered, he didn't ignore that regulation. One should not decorate his forehead with the three-lined tilak. Three-lined tilak is the Mayavadi tilak. One should not enter the temple without washing his hands and feet. So these are a list of 29. And then some other minor offenses. One should not offer food which is cooked by a non-Vaishnava. One should not worship the deity before a non-devotee. One should not engage himself in the worship of the Lord while seeing a non-devotee. This is interesting. One should begin the worship of the demigod Ganapati, who drives away all impediments in the execution of devotion service. In the Brahma Samhita, it is stated that Ganapati worships the lotus feet of the Lord Narsimhadev. And in that way, he has become auspicious for the devotees in clearing out all impediments. Therefore, all devotees should worship Ganesha. The deity should not be bathed in water which has been touched by the nails or fingers. When a devotee is perspiring, he should not engage himself in worshipping the deity. Similarly, there are many other prohibitions. One should not cross or step over the flowers offered to the deities. One should not take a vow in the name of God. So all these offenses are there in deity worship, and one should be careful to avoid them, Prabhupada writes. So regarding that point of worshipping Krishna with one's own means, according to one's capacity, we have that famous story in the Krishna book, the pastime of Shrutadeva and Bahulashva. So chapter 86 of Srimad Bhagavatam, 10th canto, describes how Krishna visited. He was in Dwarka, and one fine day he felt, I should visit these two devotees in Mithila. Their names were Shrutadeva, a Brahmana, an ordinary householder, poor Brahmana, and Bahulashva, the king of the same place, Mithila. So Prabhupada writes, pleased with both of them, the Supreme Lord mounted his chariot, Daruka as his driver, and traveled to Videha with a group of sages. And Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur says, why didn't these two devotees visit Dwarka? Krishna was here for such a long time, 100 years almost. Why didn't they take out the time and visit Dwarka? So many demigods and other people, celebrities were coming here. Why couldn't they take out the time? So there Chakravarti Thakur says, because these two devotees were unable, because both of them had vowed to regularly worship their personal deity at home, they didn't want to give up that service. Interestingly, we find that similar parallel pastime in Chaitanya Charitamrita, where Gadadhar Pandit wants to travel with Lord Chaitanya, and he wanted to give up that service to deity of Gopinath, and Mahaprabhu orders him, you should not travel like that, you should not give up that service. So, seeing Lord Krishna very merciful toward these devotees, Bahulashva and the Brahmana Shrutadev. So he mounted the chariot driven by Dwaruka, and along with him he took several other sages like Narada, Vamadev, Atri, Vyasadev, Parashuram, Asita, Shukadev, Brihaspati, Kanva, Maitreya, Chavana and others. All these sages, so usually these sages travel by foot, but because they would get exhausted by the time they reached Mithila, Lord Krishna requested them to come, join him. So all of them happily joined him. So the chariot travels at the speed of the wind. But still it is said that when Krishna was traveling through various towns and villages on the way to Mithila, people residing there could witness his form, see him clearly, because Krishna had bestowed special mercy upon them. And they came and offered several articles and worshipped Krishna. So finally he reaches Mithila, and when he reaches Mithila, both of them simultaneously come to Krishna. And both of them request Krishna to visit their home. So Shrutadeva also and Bahulashva also. So what Krishna does, he duplicates himself. One set, along with the sages, he duplicates. So one set of Krishna and the sages go to Bahulashva's palace, the other set goes to Shrutadeva's palace. And both of them don't realize that another duplicate has gone to the other place. They are under the impression that Krishna and the sages have come to my place, and poor king, he is bereft of Krishna's association. That's what Brahmana is thinking. And the king is thinking, poor Brahmana, he is bereft of my association, he is bereft of Krishna's association. So both are happy that Krishna is arriving at their place. So Bahulashva, he was equipped with all resources to worship Krishna nicely in a grand manner. He knows perfectly how everyone is engaged in materialistic affairs and Krishna is here offering him opportunity to worship him nicely. His heart was filled with love and devotion, Prabhupada writes. And his eyes were filled with tears of ecstasy. He washed the feet of his divine guests, and afterward, he and his family members sprinkled the water on their heads. He offered nice flower garlands, sandalwood pulp, incense, new garments, ornaments, lambs, cows and bulls. In a manner befitting his royal position, he worshipped each of them in this way. And then he fed them sumptuously and comfortably and made them sit comfortably. Then Bahulashva came before the Lord and started massaging his lotus feet. He placed them on his lap, and while massaging, he started offering prayers to Krishna. He offers several prayers. And at the end of offering prayers, he requests Krishna to continue staying there for some more days and give the benefit of his association to all his citizens. And Krishna, being pleased by his devotees' prayers, he agrees to stay there for some time. And at Shrutadeva's place, Krishna and his associates arrive Shrutadeva is overjoyed to welcome Krishna. So he offers a nice sitting place, simple sitting place, and he begins to dance. That's all he can do. He doesn't have any resources. Waving around, he waves his shawl. Then Shrutadeva, because he's not rich, offers only mattresses, simple mattresses, wooden planks, or straw carpets. And he welcomed them with sweet words. He glorified them, the Lord and the sages. He and his wife washed their feet, each of them. After this, he took the spray water and sprinkled them on their heads, on all the family members. And he forgot himself, actually. In that ecstasy of receiving Krishna, he completely lost himself. Then, according to his ability, he brought fruits, incense, scented water, scented clay, tulsi leaves, kusha straw, and lotus flowers. They were not costly items and could be secured very easily. But because they were offered with devotional love, Krishna and his associates accepted them. Chakravarti Thakur says, he didn't have actually even those things. He borrowed them from the neighbors, collected those items, and then offered it to Krishna and the sages. In this way, he starts offering prayers. I have fallen into the deep, dark well of householder life and am the most unfortunate person. How can the Supreme Lord Krishna, the controller of the universe, come to my place and sanctify my place? And then he offers several other prayers. And Krishna is very pleased and he agrees to stay there for some time. So this is how we see how both devotees, two extremes, one a poor Brahmana beggar and another a king, a royal position, having all resources. Both of them satisfied Krishna by worshipping Krishna according to their capacity, according to their means and capacity. So that's the thing that Krishna is looking for. Bhavagrahi Janardana. He's not looking for wealth and resources, scholarship and tapasya and all those external things. But if we have pure, sincere devotion, we can please Krishna by our devotion. A similar interesting pastime comes in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. I like this pastime very much about Gauridas Pandit. Whenever we go to Ambika Kalna, we get to hear this. How the deity is not different from Krishna. So Mahaprabhu had visited Gauridas Pandit's place in Ambika Kalna before he took sannyas. And after he took sannyas, he again visited. He and Lord Nityananda Prabhu, both of them visited Gauridas Pandit's place. And Gauridas Pandit was so overjoyed, ecstatic to receive both of them and welcomed them, offered them nice food. And after the whole event, while they were about to leave, Mahaprabhu said, we want to leave and we have to preach to the whole world, deliver all conditioned souls. So Gauridas Pandit said, no, you cannot go. I cannot stay a moment in your absence. So please stay here. I assure you that all the world will come here and you can preach to them and deliver them. You need not go everywhere. So Mahaprabhu said, that is not possible. Our mission is to go everywhere and deliver them. But then he wouldn't allow. So he cried and finally Mahaprabhu said, okay, we will give you a set of deities, myself and Nityan Prabhu's deity. You worship them, those deities are non-different from us. So he said, okay. And Mahaprabhu immediately manifested two deities, Gaur Nithai deities. And the deities were kept in the altar. And he said, whenever you wish to think of us, you treat them as identical to us. Offer them food and worship, everything. And we will accept them because they are non-different from us. And then they started moving out, walking out. So he put a condition. Wait a minute. If you say they are non-different, then you stay here and let the deities go. And you only said both are not different. So Mahaprabhu paused and both of them paused and then they went into the altar. The deities started moving out and then they took the position of the deities and they stood there on the altar. and the deity started moving out. So Gauridas Pandit said, wait. You two go there and these two let them go. So again the interchange happened. One set started moving out, one set took the position inside the altar. Again he said, wait. So this happened a couple of times, back and forth. Eventually he got confused, which are the original and which are the duplicate ones? Which are the deity forms, which are the original forms? So and then he got convinced that Gaurnitai deities and Gaurnitai persons are non-different. And then Mahaprabhu again assured him that please continue worshipping them. We assure you that we will accept all your aarti offerings, worship, devotion through the deity. And in this way you can remain happy. So that shows how the deities are non-different from Krishna. We are not worshipping any imaginary form, just a stone, a piece of stone or a metal or a wood. The way we treat them, that's how Krishna is going to reciprocate. Ye yathamam prapadyante tamstateva bhajamyaham. If you see Krishna as stone, Krishna appears as stone. If you see Krishna as a person, Krishna appears as a person. So in this way, there are several traditions, several stories in all traditions, all over India. All great temples have stories how the deity has reciprocated. Lord Jagannath's stories are unlimited. Simantadweep Jagannath's stories are unlimited. Every temple will have their own set of stories. And how the deity personally reciprocates with their devotee based on their devotion. If we can have just faith, cultivate this faith, strengthen our faith in the deity, then we can achieve perfection of our devotional service and then go back to Godhead in this life. Hare Krishna, thank you very much. Any comments or questions anyone has? Yes, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. Volume thoda. There's because you mentioned this point about dog not seeing this thing. So many years back, I was in thoda volume bada to yaar. I was in this center, small center of ISKCON. So this is a doubt which I still have. Small thing. We had made a big Janmashtami sweets and all that, and somehow it was cooks from outside which had come, and it was in a big platter. There was a lot of that sweets, kind of that barfi or something was made, and somehow it happened that nobody was there. The cooks left, and the Janmashtami was to be held at somewhere else in a big hall, so that center was open, all doors open, the kitchen was open, the front door, back door, everything was open. And everybody was engaged.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
So there was a Hare Krishna. I don't know why this volume. There was a dog that came and actually ate a part of this before the offering was done. Without, we are talking about seeing. So in such a situation when everything has been made, the cooks have left, and Janmashtami is to be celebrated, any small inputs in such a condition, the offering has not been done.
In one situation, we had in our altar, something was cooked by the Mataji in the kitchen, and it was not offered. The pujari somehow forgot or something happened. They didn't see the offering. And the other regular offerings, bhoga, prasad came out, and this item was left unoffered. So what should we do with it? Can we distribute it? This was the question we had. Is it offered? Should we treat it as prasad, or is it bhoga? What to do? I think Prem Kishore Prabhu talked to Jananias Prabhu. He had a discussion long back, and then Jananias Prabhu said, he was quoting Jayapataka Maharaj, and he said, if something is already cooked for Krishna, then we can treat it as offered also. In such situations, we can consider it as offered. Because the consciousness while cooking was meant for the pleasure of Krishna. So that way we can consider it as prasad. See, someone else can add if they have any point. Okay, Granthra Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki.